Shall we pray the prayer for illumination? God, source of all light, by your word you gave light to the soul. Pour out on us the spirit of wisdom and understanding that our hearts and minds may be opened. Amen. Today's scripture lesson is taken from Matthew book chapter 6, verses 25 to 34. Verse 25. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about the clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you? O you of little faith, so do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. This is the word of the Lord.
Indeed, for those who were here yesterday night, we praise God for the talents of many young people, and in fact that our church has such a beautiful place, and also the acoustic sound for string instrument. It was indeed a delight and pleasure, and all the more we praise God for such talent being used to raise funds for a very worthy cause. So we give thanks to God. This morning, for those who are new in our midst, I'm continuing with a series on the book of Matthew. Let's begin with a story by Harry Nowen. Harry Nowen is a Christian author and a theologian. And in his book, The Wounded Healer, he retold a story from an ancient tale from India. Now, the tale goes like this. There were four royal princes, royal brothers. They are from royal family. And these four brothers decided to say, you know, maybe they are so bored with their life as princes, and they say, okay, we are going to all learn a skill. We are going to take a few months to master a very special skill, and we're going to do something with it. So for a couple of months, the four brothers all went on their own way to learn up a special ability, a special knowledge, a special skill. So after a couple of months, they gathered back, and the first brother said, hey, look, I have mastered a very special skill. And my skill is this. I am able to take a bone of any creature and I'm able to put its flesh back on it. Bone, and I'm able to make the flesh of this creature to grow back on this bone. The second brother said, well, brother, I have discovered this skill. My skill is this, that I am able to grow skin and hair on a creature if that creature is given its flesh on its bones. The third brother folds his hand and said, ah, brothers, I have discovered that I am able to grow limbs on this creature if you're able to put flesh, skin and hair on this creature. I'm able to grow its limbs. And finally, the fourth brother said, you know what skill I have? If you are able to give this creature its flesh, its skin, its hair, its limbs, I am able to breathe life to it and make it grow alive. Ooh. Four brothers look at each other. Wow, sounds like great minds think alike. And so they decided to hurry off and go to a jungle to discover, to find a bone that they can work on. So they found a bone. Gleefully, they started. First brother, with the bone, grow flesh on it. Second brother, grow skin and hair. Third brother, grow what? Grow limbs. And finally, finale touch. The fourth brother put breath into that creature. And guess what? The creature came alive with great mane and fur, with paws, with sharp nails, and roared. It turns out the bone was a lion. And it ate all of them up and ran into the jungle. What is the moral of this story? The moral of this story is that sometimes what we create can consume us. What we create can eat us up. Our ambition, our goals can eat us up. Our material possessions, our wealth, can end up destroying us unless we first seek the giver of all things, that is God. Seek Him, seek His righteousness, and that God breathe life into our ambitions, our possessions, and be made useful for His glory. That's how you don't end up being consumed by the very thing that you create. But friends, the fact that with the society that we live in talks about having more and more desires, wants and needs. Even if you don't have, the advertisers will create them for you. Buy more stuff. Have more things. Hurry, hurry, hurry. Today, if you walk into any departmental stores at any time of the year, what do you find? Discounts. Whether it is 10%, 20%, up to 70, 80, all year round, correct? It all tells us, buy. And if we go out and we go to McDonald's, and today, now McDonald's, you order by doing your self-service, right? You go to that ordering self-counter and then you press mix and match. All kinds of variety, upsize, add more. We live in a society that talks about accumulating, having more. To have all this to satisfy our desire. But friends, we know that the scripture tells us that these things do not truly satisfy. Though food, clothes, having our handphone, are they good for us? Yes, they are good. In many ways, they give us so much benefits. But yet, friends, the ultimate point in life is that our lives are more than just this stuff. But friends, many people, because they have this lifestyle, they begin to need to finance this kind of lifestyle. I dream to have a big house, a big car, to have a certain number of zeros in my bank account. And therefore, I work towards that. And therefore, to sustain that lifestyle, we need to earn more and more. Slowly, without realizing, money and possessions have become our modern-day idols. We bow down to them and we serve them, hoping that they will meet our deepest hearts, desires, and needs. But do you know that people who have, the more we have, the more money we have, actually a lot of people are more and more worried. Many people, the more money they have, they begin to think, how do I keep this money? How do I grow this money? And then, how do I avoid people from stealing my money? The more you have, surprisingly, we think will give us more ease, more peace, more happiness, more contentment, often drives us to worry sick about these things. To worry sick about these things. That's where we have allowed the things that we are given to control us instead of being used for a greater purpose. What then is our greatest need? Our greatest need is to find God. While we need many material things, many other things around us, we need friendship, we need family, we need a good sense of work, but yet our greatest need is to find God. And I love this quote by actually a mathematician, Pascal. And he says this: there is a God-shaped vacuum in the heart of every man which cannot be filled by any other created thing, but only by God, the Creator, made known through Jesus. There is a God-shaped vacuum. There is a space in our heart that cannot be fitted by anything other than God. How many of you likes to do puzzles? Can I have a raise of hands? Love puzzles. Yes, I have seen one or two hands. Maybe a lot of you are very shy. Yeah? As far as I know, quite a number of you like to play puzzles. I'm not one of them. You know, puzzles, you have to have the right pieces to put in, right? And some of the most challenging ones is actually to have one that is of the sky, clouds, because every piece look almost the same, right? Blue, shades of blue. But those who love puzzles would just get crazy over it. They find it so challenging. But you see, if it's not that piece that fit, it will not fit, correct? May look the same, may look like it fits, but it doesn't fit. Doesn't fit. There is something in us that only God can fit perfectly. Try to fit it with some other things, it doesn't fit. And when it doesn't fit perfectly, what does it produce? It produces restlessness, discontentment. And therefore, many people who have many things in life, achievement, accomplishment, can still feel very restless and discontentment if what is there in us is not properly filled. Jesus says this to us. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what your life will eat or drink, or about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? In other words, what Jesus is telling us is, if God is our greatest need, don't get so preoccupied with getting. One friend once told me, she and her husband got into a very deep disagreement with the son, the youngest son, probably about 16 years old. So I said, what's the matter about? I thought it was some very, very serious matter, but it's all about a handphone. It's about a handphone that the son wants, and the parents could not agree with that handphone. Many times our lives, we find that it is so important, but really if we investigate, is that thing that we cling on, that we are busy getting, is it really that important? Is your life worth more than the money that you have? Is your life worth more than that handphone, that computer, that result, that A you want to get, that promotion? Is your life worth more than that? So don't get too preoccupied with hoarding, accumulating. But Jesus tells us, the key is this. The key is to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all these things, God is not saying that, you know, what we need, the food, the life, the things that we need in our life, God knows. He didn't say that these are not important. Our studies, our career, our home, they are not important. They are. But if we put the first thing first, if we seek God first, we pursue Him first, we put Him first priority, then God will meet all our needs. All these things will be added to you. This is a very important thing. Why seek God first? If we know God, we know that He is our Lord, our Master, then we know that actually we are in His hands and He has a responsibility over us. Many of you here are parents, right? If you give birth to a child, you have all the intention to raise him or her up, give the best education, help the person to grow in character, and expose the person to sometimes even mistakes, allow the person to have room to make mistakes, the person to grow under safe watch of our eyes. Because you know why? Our child needs to know that we love them and we will care for them because they are under our watch. God says when He says, seek me first, He is also saying that I will too take care of you. If you know you are in whose hands, you will know that I am worthwhile to be the first priority. I like what Bishop Robert Solomon in his book, Sermon of Jesus, he made an observation about Maslow hierarchy of needs. I think most of you are familiar with this theory. In this theory, it says that we have needs, and the ranking of the needs are such. First layer is our physical needs, followed by safety, belonging or love, esteem. And finally, what is the highest need or great, the highest pinnacle of our human need is self-actualization. Means able to meet our highest potential. And Bishop Solomon, he make a remark and he says this, as people of God's kingdom, our lives are not at this hierarchy. And he makes two observations. He says first, the triangle or the pyramid has to be inverted, has to go upside down. Somebody familiar? Upside down, inside out. Can make a song of the sermon series before this. It has to go upside down. Instead of self-actualization, our highest need and our greatest need is God. But when you have God, all these things shall be added unto you. Do you hear the words of Jesus ringing in our ear? Our need for esteem, for love, for safety, for our physical bodily need, God knows, and it filters down. God has to take precedence, and we see Him meeting, flowing through God to meet all our other needs. I think this is a very wise observation about how we should look at priorities, our needs, and God. First thing first is put God first. Seek Him first. Let Him work things out for us. But Jesus knows that human beings, all of us, have a tendency to worry. The thought of leaving it to God, though actually, you know, Jesus has just said, you know, that's God's promise to us. He says, seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added. It is a promise from God. It is a promise, but He knows that, humanly speaking, we have trust issues. And often, we still worry. So Jesus says, beginning by verse 25, after He tells us not to serve money or any other things, but choose to serve God, He says, therefore, verse 25, I tell you, do not worry about your life. This word, do not worry, in its original language in Greek, it is a verb imperative. Means it is not just a suggestion. It is not something that is an advice. But verb imperative means it is a command. Jesus commands us not to worry. Not to worry. This is a command by Jesus. Why is that so? Because the scripture tells us, and through what Jesus is explaining to us in the text, to worry is to fail to trust God. To worry is to fail to trust God. Let's look at this verse in verse 26. Okay, can we have the next slide? Okay, sorry, move back. Verse 26, it says, "Look at the birds in the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life?" You know, this commentator, Rusby, he actually says this. It's often said that we are continually being crucified between the two thieves. What are the thieves? The first thief is the regret of yesterday, and the other thief is the worries of tomorrow. I think it's very important why we must not worry. It's because, firstly, it is a failure to trust God because we do not know that God truly cares for us. So the first thing to overcome worry is to know that God truly cares for us. There is a father of faith in the early centuries of Christianity. His name is Augustine. And he once said this. He said that God loves us as if there is only one of us in this world. God loves us as if we are the only one person in this world. So can I ask for a favor? Turn to the person next to you and say, God loves you as if you are the only one in this world. I think we need to understand this line. Aren't you far more valuable than him, than the birds of the air? You know, when we look around creation, and we all know how God cares for those things around us, right? The birds in the air, the flowers. It is amazing how beautiful flowers can be. The shades of color in its petals. Look at the birds, you know, they chirp away and then they just go on freely flying around. But this is very important for us to understand that we are very valuable to God. We're actually very valuable to God. Not because we are talented, or there's many things we can offer God, or that because we come from a very godly family. God, we are very valuable to God because God is love. And he sees each one of us very special. He is proud of us. Of course, it doesn't mean that God is ignorant of our weaknesses. But the very fact that we are created in his image, God is proud of us. He takes pride in us. He relentlessly refuses to give up on us. We are very valuable to God. So when we say we worry, it's to not trust that God loves us enough. God doesn't understand us enough. God doesn't comprehend the challenges that we face. But the scriptures tells us again and again, God cares, he knows, and he values us. And that is something that we need to know, that God cares for us. Josh Miller is an evangelist, and he is also well known for starting orphanages. This during somewhere around 19th century, and over in his many years of ministry, he has taken care of more than 10,000 children, started more than 100 different orphanages and schools, and also provided education to more than 170,000 children. It was said that John Miller, at one point, in the orphanage, they were going through a very tough time, and they were so poor that one morning they didn't even have any food. available, nothing in the kitchen. And there was no money in the drawer of the office. Nothing. And Josh Mueller that morning came into the hall, the dining hall, together with all the children, all seated at their long tables with the plates spread out, fork and spoon and cup, but all empty. And Josh Mueller said, "Children, let us see what God our Father will do for us. Let us pray." And he prayed, "God, today we thank you for what you are going to feed us this morning. Amen." I don't think I have faith like that, but that's what Josh Mueller did. He said that to the children, and just as they finished the prayer, they heard a knock and from the door, the main door, and somebody came in and said, "There is somebody at the door. It's our local baker." And so Josh Mueller went out and met with the baker, and the baker said, "George, this early this morning at 2 o'clock in the morning, I woke up. I just got jolted out from my sleep, and I had this strong impression in my heart that God is telling me that you don't have bread this morning." So he said, At that morning, I began to bake bread at 2 o'clock in the morning, and here are the bread for all of you and your children." Our Heavenly Father loves us very much. He knows. He knows our needs because He cares. He cares. We cannot put God and liken Him to the human persons that we know in our lives. For some of us, or even our own biological parents, may not have met or would have said, if I would put it in a negative way, some of our biological parents would have failed us in some ways. And sometimes we, without realizing, we equate God very much with our Father, Heavenly Father. But the scriptures again and again tells us that God is a loving God. He does meet all our needs. So to know that how God cares for us in a time where we're struggling with our worry, what can we do? Is to learn to think about His love. These are words from a song. It says, think about His love. Think about His goodness. Think about His grace that has brought me through, or us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love. You know, the one of the ways when we are worrying about something is to stop that and think about God's love. Think about His love. Think about His goodness through your life. Think about His grace. Think of Him. That is one way that we can begin to overcome our worry. Secondly, worry does not change things. Please tell the person next to you, worry does not change things. I think many of us need to hear this, including myself. Worry does not change things. And Jesus brings this out by highlighting to us the foolishness of worrying. Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? Can any one of us add a day, make anything by worrying itself? It can't. That's why worry does not change things. This quote says, don't worry. God is never blind to your tears, never deaf to your prayers, and never silent to your pains. He sees, He hears, and He will deliver. So don't worry. So what should we do when we are battling with our concerns over the things in our life? The result is, stop worrying. The action that we must take is to stop. So whenever we begin to think, and then we cannot sleep, cannot eat. Maybe can eat, but cannot sleep. Some people must eat, very important. Cannot sleep. You must consciously tell yourself, this is the word of Jesus, who knows us and loves us with perfect love. Stop. You have to tell yourself, stop. It is a command by my Lord. Stop. Because it doesn't change anything. It doesn't produce any results. So that is something that we need to begin to act. By just choosing to stop, it is already a good step. It is already a good step. Now, we know first is, how do we shift our attention away from our worry? Number one, we know that to center our thought on God who cares for us. Secondly, we know it is to stop worrying. Third, these are the third thing that's quite important is to pay attention to what God is doing right now in your life, in your situation, in the circumstances that you are struggling with. Stop, look, and listen. Friends, do you think that if somebody cares for you, the person will do nothing or be blinded to what you are going through? No, right? Often we find that close friends or family members, when you come back after a long day from work and you have some struggles at the workplace, immediately they know by your facial expression, your body language, what you don't say, they know that you have had a difficult day. Close, caring family members and friends do that. Amen? Yes, they know. So, they are there because they are doing something for us as we go through that. Do you think that those who really love us will fold their hands and say, it is your life, leave it as it is? No. Those who love us and care for us will walk with us. And so God, our Heavenly Father, He is constantly doing things in our life that though we may not see with our eyes. Correct? Many times we think that God is silent means God is not working. God is silent, that's it's not working, but doesn't mean often God works. God is up to something even when we cannot see. It's by the time we see it, it's the culmination of God's work behind the scene. Take for example the election in 9th of May in our country. God has been working behind the scene all the years. All the years God has been working. We didn't see. We don't see. But doesn't mean God is not working. So friends, it's very important, rather than worrying, is to begin to try to channel our attention to what God is doing right now. So one good thing is when you are going through an issue and you're worried about, let's say, your job, about the exam you're going to face, one thing to ask is, God, what would you like to teach me through what I'm going through? God, why place this difficult person in my life? Is it to torment me for my past sins? But ask instead, God, surely in your goodness and mercies, you love me and want me to grow. What are you trying to teach me? What are you trying to do? I love this picture about Jesus going to the Cana. Remember, he was invited to a wedding and he has not come out to public ministry yet, and he was with his band of brothers, his friends. And lo and behold, there was a crisis. No wine for a wedding, which is like, you know, is going to be the greatest embarrassment if you don't serve your guests during the festive with enough wine. And lo and behold, Jesus was asked to do something about it. And even though he resisted in the beginning because it was not time yet, but yet he decided to. And remember, he asked the workers to fill up the jars with water. And then later he asked the workers to give the water to the master to drink. Did Jesus have a plan? He has. Did he say, and what is his plan to all the workers? Guys, let me present to you my PowerPoint presentation, how I'm going to solve this crisis. Number one, we will resolve the water supply by... No! God doesn't. Sometimes in his wisdom, he doesn't. But doesn't mean that if we don't pay attention, if you are that worker standing there, you're not paying attention to Jesus, you will not have the privilege of witnessing the miracle that he's going to do. That amazing turning of water to wine in abundance. It is a sign of the coming of the kingdom of God. Friends, in crisis in your life, where it plunges you into the darkness of worrying, you are about to witness something great that God can do if you choose to pay attention to what God is doing. Just pay attention. God in his good time will reveal to you. You can't demand God, tell me your plan. Let me see whether we are in agreement of this and let's sign and then we will proceed. Doesn't work, my friends. Pay attention first. And God will reveal to you his marvelous way in his time. How do we pay attention? Friends, often it is in prayer. In prayer. God will not drop you an email. You try checking in your Google Mail, in your Yahoo Mail, and whatever. God will not send you an email to you. This is the plan, you know. God will not drop you an email, so don't try to find God's plan through emails, but in prayer. We love Philippians 4, 6 to 7. It says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and by supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. It is in prayer, in a thanksgiving, in reflecting of God's goodness. You know, when we think about God and his goodness, what overflows from us is thanksgiving. It's a natural spiritual experience. When you really know and think about God's amazing love and his deeds in your life, the natural outflow is thanksgiving, because we realize how undeserving we are and how great God's powerful deeds are. There's this parent who brought his son to a coffee shop, one of their favorite coffee shops, and it was lunchtime, and it was just so many people gathering at the tables, and they were eating, and before, they weren't eating, they were waiting for the food, and the food arrived. But because it was so crowded, the father told the young son, son, let us have silent prayer on our own. So they bowed their heads, and the father prayed, and then he opened his eyes. The son was still praying, with his hand folded and his eyes closed. And it was quite a long while. After a while, the father was thinking, what's going on? And finally, the boy opened up his eyes. And the father asked him gently and said, boy, what on earth are you doing all that time praying? What are you praying about? And the son answered innocently, how will I know that? You say it's a silent prayer. Silent prayer doesn't mean you do nothing, you say nothing. Silent prayer means waiting. Wait upon God. Actually, in prayer, more than often, it is silence and waiting, active waiting, rather than talking. If we must not think that our prayer starts and stops with us uttering our Heavenly Father and Amen. Prayer is an ongoing process. We begin with our thanksgiving and we pour out our hearts to God. And it's like a conversation that we may have to pause for a while, like watching a TV, we pause as we go to work. But that prayer continue on because it is an ongoing conversation. And in conversation with God in prayer, there are many, many pauses and silence. But that silence doesn't mean that God is not speaking to us. There's nothing happening within us. So silent doesn't mean that it's doing nothing. It is an active spiritual being in waiting for God. In waking, we ask, we contemplate, and we put our trust in God. I like what William Barclay reminds us when we pray, and especially in those moments where we have not had our answer in our prayer, and our hearts grow weary, anxious. How can we get out of this situation? When we pray, especially in moments of silence, seemingly silence from God, we remember, one, the love of God that wants the best for us. If God can care for the birds and the flowers, as insignificant as they are, and we are so much more valuable to God, will not God's love desire the best for you and I? Secondly, the wisdom of God that knows what is best for us. God knows our heart more than ourselves. The scripture says the heart is very deceiving. We may think that this relationship must work. It is the only relationship. This is the only girl I will going to marry. But sometimes God in His wisdom knows better. Knows better. And when the relationship doesn't work out, perhaps God has other plans for us that we may not see given our limited knowledge. Thirdly, the power of God can accomplish it. The power of God is great. The power that raised Christ from the dead and set us free from the curse of sin. That power is available for our situation. And so this is what we need to remember. Fourthly, trust God to help us deal with tomorrow. The words of Jesus tells us this: therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough troubles of its own. What Jesus is basically telling us is this: meet today's problems with today's strength. Don't start tackling tomorrow's problem until tomorrow. I think it's wonderful advice from Jesus. Do not worry, for tomorrow will have its own worries. So settle for today. Settle for today. Max Lucado, which is a Christian author, in his book, which is written for mothers. It was a book written, and the book's title is, one section is, The What Ifs and How Else, of the Burden of Worry. He says this: God will help you deal with whatever hard things comes when the hard things that comes up when the time comes. And he went on to emphasize when the time comes. Friends, when we say we want to trust God with tomorrow, means that we need to trust that God has given us enough strength for today. What God has for us in store for us tomorrow, God already know. Okay? God already know what we need for tomorrow, because He knows us. He has also prepared what we need for tomorrow is there. That strength, that wisdom, that providence is there. But He will not give what is for tomorrow today. What we have today, we use it for today. In other words, take one day at a time. Take one day at a time. Ask God, God, you have made available strength, wisdom, providence for today. And help me trust you. When the time comes tomorrow, I will have the strength. So he then went on in his book and say, some people will say, you know, how would I cope when my children leave home? Will I be able to work through that loneliness? And his answer is, yes, when the time comes, God will give strength for that sense of emptiness at home. What will happen when, if my spouse leaves before me, what will happen to me? Can I survive? The answer is yes. God will be able to pull you through when the time comes. So important to understand, we live with God's strength for today. We can't demand God, give me that which is for tomorrow. It is an act of faith that when tomorrow comes, that thing that God has prepared for us, we will receive on time. I recently sent a birthday parcel to a friend. So there was a tracking number, and after about a week, I checked online and found that it was not delivered. and then went and called and say, you know, this and that and this and that. You know, some things like that in life, we find, it doesn't deliver. Say, promise to go in, arrive in 7 days. It didn't arrive. But God is not that kind of God. What He has prepared, it will arrive. That package of wisdom, of whatever that is needed, will arrive on time, when the time comes. During the World War II, many children suffered, lost their parents, many had to find shelter for their lives, and many of the children during the war didn't have enough food to eat. Very hungry, they suffered nights going to sleep without food. And so when the war ended and they put all these kids in the orphanage, they found that even though they have given food to the kids, they have given shelter to the kids, many of the children still couldn't sleep at night. You know, they already had a shelter and food, but they cannot sleep. So they tried many ways to help these children to overcome their fear. Finally, somebody found a way. When the children all go to sleep at night, each one of them is given a small piece of bread. A small little piece of bread. And the child will hold that piece of bread in the palm of his or her hand and goes to sleep. That piece of bread reminds the child, since I have eaten today, I will eat tomorrow. Friends, every night when we go to sleep, we hold on to God as the bread of life. Since I have eaten from God's grace and mercy and kindness and goodness, I still have breath alive today. That piece of bread, God, I will have tomorrow. Live today with today's strength given by God, tomorrow by God's strength. So friends, let us hear the words of Jesus once again ringing our ears. Seek the kingdom of God above all else. Live righteously, and God will give you everything you need. First thing first, and we'll see all the rest that we need, God will faithfully meet. Let us pray. Let us just take this moment to be quiet before God who is here with us and ask this question, Lord, what are you saying to me this morning? Let's just give God this space and time. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you, O God, that through your Son, Jesus Christ, we hear these powerful words. Seek you first. Live according to your ways. And we see how faithfully you will meet our needs. Lord, you know our weakness. We worry so much. Lord, you commanded us not to worry. It's futile. It doesn't change anything. Help us, O God, because we are weak, but you are strong. Help us to trust you for who you are, to learn to use today's strength as you have given us, and have faith that tomorrow you will do likewise. Meet us where we are, O Lord. Will you be so gracious to us this morning? For some of us, O God, you know the burdens that we carry in our hearts, in our minds. And this morning we want to say, Lord, I don't know how. I have been a worrier all my life, but today I hear your words, your living word. Help me to stop worrying, to trust you, to rely on you. Help me, O God, somehow in your own ways, for you know me. Lord, we come before you with this earnest request. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.